Hello everyone. Thank you very much for watching. First of all, I'd like to thank all of you. I'd like to thank the organizers of the conference. I'd like to thank all of those who are watching me. I will be coming through my presentation. I wish I was able to join the conference, but due to several issues, I am talking to you through this video. So I will present my paper, and I hope you enjoy my presentation. The title of my presentation is Prediction of Monthly Stream Flow Using Extreme Gradient Boosting and Extreme Learning Machine. This paper was prepared by five authors, and I am the first author. Talking about sustainability, of course, the name of the conference is Sustainable Building, but sustainability is not only for buildings. It has many aspects, such as the health of the soil, the health of the forest, clean air. And also one of the most important, in my opinion, one of the most important aspect is the clean water. And also not all this, not only this, we have also in sustainability ethics and also human rights. And these are the most important aspects, in my opinion, for the sustainability, for the sustainability of the life. That's why the United Nations has developed 17 sustainable development goals. These goals, starting from no poverty in the first goal, going it through to 17th goal, which is the partnerships of for the goals. Of course, we can't say this one goal is more important than another goal. They are all important, but in our application, according to our specialists, the most important goals is, for example, the clean water and sanitation, climate action, life below water, life on land. This also partnerships for the goals. Also, in order to develop to implement these goals, we need to partnerships. I do repeat here that we are not saying this one is more important or another one. All are important. Coming to the our objective, I mean to the objectives of the objective of the conference, the World Green Building Council has put this figure, and in order to explain the role of sustainable building, or they are saying here green building. Of course, green building is not much different from sustainable building. This green or sustainable, they are used interchangeably, but in my opinion, sustainable is more general, and green building is just can be under sustainable buildings. So the role of sustainable green buildings are explained here. Taking an example, coming to, for example, to the 15th goal, which is life on land, it says here green buildings can improve biodiversity, save water resources, and help to protect forests. And also, taking another example, on the third goal, which is good health and well-being, it says that green buildings can improve people's health and well-being. That's why what I'm saying here is green buildings are important for all the most of the development, sustainable development goals identified by the United Nations. And coming to my topic, which is the most, in my opinion, of course, the most important sustainable factor is the fresh water. Because without water, no life. No water means no life. And if we look at that, 71% of the Earth's surface covered by water. Out of this 71, only 2.5% is the fresh water. And most of this 2.5 is locked up in ice and in the ground. So out of 2.5, only 1% is readily available fresh water. That's the rivers and the lakes, including stream flows, of course. Looking at this figure, we can say that sustainable fresh water, sustainable fresh water, or having fresh water is the most important goal. Why is that? Because all the other goals are controlled by this by this goal. So having but without, as I said earlier, without water, no life. Saying that, coming to our objectives, the objectives of our paper. The objectives is starting by using the artificial intelligence in predicting stream flow. Of course, we are talking about predicting monthly stream flow. Why we are predicting stream flow monthly? It's very important, of course. That can be used as an application. It can be used for monitoring or mitigating droughts and also floods, and at the same time monitoring the level of the reservoir, and so that's why it's very important in our application. Going narrower to our objectives is to use extreme gradient boosting this model, and which according to our knowledge it has not been used in predicting the stream flow in the literature. It's the first time used in predicting stream flow, and the results of this model is will be compared with the well test extreme learning machine method. The extreme learning machine method is the we can say that developed artificial neural network, the ANN model. So we are going to predict the monthly stream flow 1 month ahead. Of course, in order to examine our models, we have to have case study. In our paper, we have chosen this basin called Gökçe or Gökdere, or as a code, it's quoted as 1805. It's located in the southeast of Turkey. The data used in this paper is the daily stream flow, which is measured in the downstream. This is the downstream, and at the upstream. This is the upstream for the period of 1973 to 1994, and also the daily stream flow, which is collected from the Department of the Water Affairs, were converted to monthly. And also another important part, which is due to the non-existence of a meteorological station inside the basin, in the center of the basin, the rainfall and temperature data were interpolated using IDW, inverse distance weighting method, by using 17 stations around the basin. So we interpolated the rainfall and temperature in this point, as no meteorological station located in the space inside the basin. And also the monthly potential evapotranspiration were also obtained from the crude TS 3.23 data, which is available online. This is credit data. In order to do the prediction, we have done, first of all, we have used autocorrelation function and cross-correlation function to obtain the optimum lags of all the variables used as an input. In this paper, we have found that two lags of downstream and two lags of upstream flow are optimal, and one lag for the evapotranspiration, temperature and rainfall is the optimum lags that can be used as inputs. Also, in the same time, we have done some several combinations. These combinations are six. We have done six combinations, starting by downstream. The first combination is only downstream that we are seeing here. Downstream is used, the lag downstream are used for predicting the downstream 1 month ahead. In the second combination, downstream and upstream are used as inputs for predicting the downstream 1 month ahead. And also the same thing for the others. For example, the third one is the downstream upstream rainfall temperature. The fourth one is downstream upstream evapotranspiration and temperature. The fifth one is downstream upstream rainfall evapotranspiration. While in that sixth one, the last one is all the input, all the variables we have has been used as the inputs, and that's it's downstream upstream rainfall evapotranspiration and temperature. All the data used in this, all the variables used in the prediction has been normalized. Was normalized by using between B.1 and 1 by using this equation. So as a result, of course, coming before coming to the results, it's an important issue or an important part of extreme gradient boosting model is it has several parameters, and these parameters, of course, including maximum depth, eta, gamma, minimum child weight, and subsample, and so on. These parameters need to be must be optimized to have the best performance. In this paper, we have used the hyperparameter optimization algorithm for optimizing these parameters, and the optimized parameter are listed in this table. For the extreme learning machine, only the best number of the hidden neuron is important, in the hidden layer, of course, is important, but not reported here due to the to save some space. Coming to the results of the extreme learning machine, the use of only for the in the first combination, using only the downstream flow as a lag downstream flow as an input, we can get a weak model that has a low Nutsatcliffe coefficient and very high root mean square error. We are going and also the inclusion of other variables increases the performance of the model, as can be seen here. And also in the test subsample. Considering only the test subset in evaluating the performance of the extreme learning machine, we can say that downstream, upstream rainfall, evapotranspiration, combination, this combination is the best performed combination. For coming to the extreme gradient boosting, the combination with only the downstream also has the lowest performance. This is the first one. Also other stories, and also the same thing, including another variable, using another other variables downstream, and such as temperature, rainfall, and others, improving the performance of the models. And also the best performed model is the model that has all the variables, which is the last combination. And in this slide, we are comparing the two models, XGB and ELM. And we can say, looking at the Tyler diagram, we can say that the XGB is more closer to the observations, which is, of course, in terms of the standard deviation, and also has the highest correlation and the least error. That's why we can say XGB is more outperformed extreme learning machine. That's also obvious in the on this figures. And scatter plots of the observed versus the predicted. We can say in the extreme learning machine, the points are more scattered farther from the 1-1 line, while in the extreme gradient boosting, the points are more closer to the 1-1 line. So coming to the results, we can say that the downstream, upstream, rainfall, evapotranspiration combination, which contains all the variables except the temperature, is the best performed. Why is that? Because the evapotranspiration is already calculated using the temperature. So including both of them, due to collinearity, we can, including both evapotranspiration and temperature, could deteriorate the performance of the model. But this is not the case in using XGB. Why is that? Because XGB has the, a very important advantage and characteristics, which is can use only the important features, inputs, we can say. It uses only the important features, and any important features are excluded from the calculations. Of course, this is not our point. This can be discussed in another article. Coming to the conclusion, we can say, of coming to conclusion and conclude our paper, we can say that extreme learning machine and XGB used in this paper and evaluated and compared both of them, in this paper, downstream flow 1 month ahead used as output, while lagged downstream, upstream, rainfall, temperature, and potential evapotranspiration used as inputs, including variables beside the lagged downstream. Such as these variables, such as upstream rainfall, potential evapotranspiration, and temperature, improves the model performance dramatically. Extreme learning machine is a very fast algorithm, as it does not need any tuning process. While XGB is slower, of course, because as I said earlier, it needs the tuning of the parameter. XGB performed better than extreme learning machine in terms of predicting accuracy, although XGB is a tree-based model. It's also another important part has been discovered, discovered by the authors in this paper. XGB has a very important advantage, which is the importance matrix, which explicitly identify the most and least important features in the model. And as I said earlier, we can put as many as inputs as many as features in, as inputs, but the XGB has the ability to select the important features out of them to use them in the prediction, and this is very important. Coming to the end of the presentation, I'd like to thank all of you for listening, and I hope you have you enjoy the conference, and have a nice day, all of you, and thank you.